हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल ऑफ यू। आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम डॉक्टर निवेदिता नाथ फॉर दिस सेशन, एंड शी इज वर्किंग एज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन गंगाधर मेहर यूनिवर्सिटी। ऑल्सो शी हैज बीन अपॉइंटेड एज द हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एंथ्रोपोलॉजी। हर रिसर्च एरियाज इंक्लूड सोशल एंथ्रोपोलॉजी एंड ट्राइबल स्टडीज। टूडे शी विल टेक ए क्लास ऑन हिस्टोरिकल मूरिंग्स एंड बेसिस ऑफ सोशल हिंदू सोशल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, व्हिच इज ए पार्ट ऑफ इंडियन सोसाइटी, एंड शी विल गो थ्रू ऑल द फोर यूनिट्स। नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर नाथ टू टेक ओवर द सेशन। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू संगमित्रा मैडम, थैंक यू जयश्री मैडम, गुड आफ्टरनून डियर स्टूडेंट। टुडे वी शैल डील विद द चैप्टर हिस्टोरिकल मूरिंग्स एंड बेसिस ऑफ हिंदू सोशल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन। इन दिस चैप्टर वी विल बी डीलिंग विद फोर यूनिट्स, द वर्णम व्यवस्था एंड इट्स रेलिवेंस, द आश्रम व्यवस्था एंड इट्स रेलिवेंस, द पुरुषार्थ एंड इट्स रिलेशनशिप विथ आश्रमस, एंड द डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ कर्म। Now I request Nishanta to present for me the PowerPoint.
Okay.
So as I already told that in this chapter has been divided into four units, and we will discuss about the different bases of Hindu social organization. And first we will discuss what is organization. Organization is the process of doing, keeping things in an orderly fashion. Then what is social organization? Social organization is the pattern or arrangement of actions or behaviors which conforms with the norms and values of the society. Then after understanding organization and social organization, now let us discuss what is Hindu social organization. The principles, the beliefs, the ideas that guide the actions and behaviors of the people of Hindu society are called Hindu social organization. And in today's class, we shall discuss in briefly all the bases of Hindu social organization very briefly, and we shall discuss in detail the four bases of Hindu social organization, which are very, very important. And those four bases of Hindu social organization are Varna Vyavastha, Ashrama Vyavastha, Purushartha, and the Doctrine of Karma in detail. So now let us first discuss what are the basis of Hindu social organization. Hinduism is the oldest religion in the world. Hindu sacred texts deals with ethical behavior of an individual and society. Those rules of conduct are applied to the personal and social life of human beings of Hindu society. Now let us discuss what are those bases that guide the Hindu way of life. The first is life cycle. Please note down, students. The first point of Hindu social organization is life cycle. The Hindus believe that each human being has a soul, and the soul is immortal. Means it does not perish at the time of death. It again takes birth in another form. This process of birth and rebirth goes until moksha is attained. Once birth or rebirth in a particular state of existence is believed by the Hindus to be dependent on the quality of life of one's deeds or karmas. So this birth and rebirth depends upon one's karmas. Depending on one's own karmas, one attains the stage of moksha or liberation. The stage of moksha or liberation is the end of life cycle of birth and rebirth. And moksha or liberation has paramount importance among the Hindus. Nishant, please take forward the slides.
Okay, ma'am.
Huh. Yes, this we have already discussed that there are four units in the slide. Next, please. Next, please. Yes. So the first point we have discussed, life cycle, and now let us discuss the second point. The second point is harmony. What is harmony? In Hinduism, there is harmony between the actions by different parts of body and various aspects of social life. So we find harmony in two different aspects. First is different parts of body, and second is various aspects of social life. A person performs actions mentally, mano, through spoken words, vachana, and through body reactions, karma. So there should be harmony between the mind, the words, and the actions. That is, there should be harmony between the mana, the vachana, and the karma. This has been told in Hinduism. And besides this harmony between mana, vachana, and karma, mind, word, and action, there are various aspects of social life, like religion, ritual, beliefs, etc., which are also interrelated and interconnected. Now let us come to the third point. The third point is hierarchy. What is hierarchy? Hierarchy means arrangement of things in a high to low order or a low to high order. That is called hierarchy. Means upar niche, upar tala heki thiba. So hierarchy is another base of Hindu social organization. Hierarchy persists in terms of caste system in Indian society, which is deeply rooted in the Hindu society. It also exists in the qualities such as sattva, raja, and tama. In our society, in our Vedas and Puranas, we have been told about these three qualities, sattva, raja, and tama. It also exists in the value system of purusartha, karma, artha, dharma, moksha. These are the four purusarthas, karma, artha, dharma, moksha. In the caste system, how hierarchy is maintained? In the caste system, Brahmins occupy the topmost position. It is followed by the Kshatriyas, and then the Vaishyas and the Sudras at the bottommost level. Now, let us discuss what is the hierarchy in the qualities of life. The three qualities are sattva, raja, and tama. Sattva refers to the brightness and virtues and is possessed by the sages and the Brahmins. It is the highest type of virtue, a most virtuous among all the three gunas. And raja comes next to the sattva. It refers to the passionate commitment of action, and Kshatriyas possess this raja guna. Now let us come to tama. Tama is the lowest type of guna and is possessed by the Shudras. It is associated with dullness and impulse, profane inclinations. So we found that in caste system also there is a hierarchy. In the three basic gunas, the qualities of man as mentioned in Hinduism has also a system of hierarchy. And the Hindu value system, the Purusartha, there is also a hierarchy. Dharma is the highest goal of life. Among all the Purusarthas, Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, Dharma is the highest goal of life, which refers to moral obligations in the realm of social, religious, and cultural sphere. And the next is Artha, which indicates accumulation of wealth. And the third goal of life is Kama, which refers to the pursuit of worldly pleasure or enjoyment. But the ultimate goal of life, the ultimate value of life is Moksha, which is the attainment of salvation. And among these four Purusarthas, Kama is given the lowest priority. So Dharma is given the highest priority, then Artha, and Kama is given the lowest priority among all the Purusarthas. So this is how a hierarchy is maintained among the human qualities, among the caste system, and also in the Purusartha of Indian social system. Now let us discuss segmental division of society. on the basis of division of labor, different privileges and disabilities of various groups, the Hindu society has been divided into different segments. The different segments are based on the division of labor. And this division of labor is also based on the charismatic qualities, that is the gunas, which we already discussed, that is sattva, raja and tama. And we have already discussed that sattva is associated with Brahmins, raja is with Kshatriyas and tama is occupied by the Shudras. So this is how the Hindu society has again been divided into different segments, different divisions. The whole society has been divided into different segments and divisions. Then, now let us discuss the fifth point, that is the point of concept and the concept of purity and pollution. The idea of purity and pollution has sufficiently influenced the Hindu life. Purity and pollution are given much, much importance on the occasion of birth, marriage, menstruation, death, and offering prayers to God and other kinds of rituals also. We differentiate what is pure and what is impure, what is pure and what is polluted in different occasions of birth, death, marriage, and other kinds of rituals. So the term purity has wider implications. It not only confined to actions of man, but also it extends to the level of thinking of man. Thinking ill of others is also considered as impure. So this purity and pollution is not only associated with different rituals in our day-to-day life, with marriage, death, it is also associated with our thought. We can't have impure thoughts. We cannot think ill of others. We cannot have negative feelings. Then now let us come to the next basis of Hindu social organization. The next is monolithic character. That means Hinduism is not a uniform religion. We do not, in Hinduism, a single god is not worshipped. The Hindu religion worships many gods and goddesses. So it is not monolithic in nature or character. The next base of Hindu social organization is male ascendancy. The Hindu society has always accorded emphasis on males, on men. Indian society is patriarchal in nature. I hope everybody understand what is patriarchal. Patriarchal means dominance of father, authority in the father's hand. Lineage will flow in the father's line, in the male line. So the male ascendancy has been unquestionably accepted throughout the ages in the Hindu society. It is not that women are not respected, but still male have dominated the social and religious life of Hindus throughout the ages and till today also. Now, we can discuss also about some other bases of Hindu social organization. One can be discussed, that is transcendentalism. It is another feature of Hindu social life. Hindu social life, there is the belief that life transcends its existence on earth, that is, jiva and maya represent the earthly things, whereas soul and life after death represent a higher level of existence. So transcendentalism is also one of the basis of Hindu society. Then we can discuss another base of Hindu society, that is ahimsa or non-violence. Ahimsa or non-violence is the very soul of Hindu social life. The concept of dharma is based on the concept of ahimsa. It is regarded as essential attribute of man, not to harm any living being, whether man or animal or tree. So ahimsa is one of the main basis of our Hindu society. And charity to all and malice towards none is the basis of ahimsa. Then another basis of Hindu social organization is bhakti. Bhakti is the root of our dharma. It is the method of pleasing gods or goddesses. It is through bhakti that a religious person tries to control his mind and soul. So we give utmost importance to bhakti in our society. Another point is familism. What is familism? Familism means the subordination of individual interest to the interest of family as a whole. That means individual interests are not important. The interest, the benefit of the family is most important. So family is the gestalt of our Indian society, particularly the rural society, which are predominantly agrarian in nature. And we have joint family system, which is based on familism, and it has dominated all other forms of organization in India. So joint family is a strong basis of our Hindu society. Then another point is attitude of synthesis. So in India, in our Hindu society, there is an attitude of synthesis. Synthesis has been the main characteristics of Indian society. The Hindu society and culture has adopted all types of social institutions. We have synthesized various viewpoints, and therefore India is not a country with one religion, with one kind of people. Therefore, India is said to have unity and diversity, unity in diversity. Then the next basis of Hindu social organization is ascriptive systems. Hindu social organization is based on the principle of birth and status. The status of a person is determined by his birth. And the status groups are also based on birth and ascription rather than achievement. But of course, nowadays there has been a change in this, and now statuses are being achieved by people rather than being ascribed to some extent. Then another basis of Hindu social organization is Rinas. These are the three Rinas that a person has to repay within its lifetime. What are those three Rinas? Deva Rina, Pitru Rina, and Rishi Rina. The debt of the teacher who gave us knowledge, that is called Rishi Rina. The debt of the ancestors who gave us birth, from whom we have descended, is called the Pitru Rina. So, throughout our life, we have to repay this Deva Rina, Rishi Rina, and Pitru Rina, and then only we can attain salvation or moksha. So these are the different bases of Hindu social organization that we discussed very briefly. But as I have already told, we shall discuss four bases in very detailed way. And those four bases are Varna Vyavastha, Ashrama Vyavastha, Purusharthha, and the doctrine of karma. So we shall start with Varna Vyavastha. Nishant, please take to the next slide. I request Nishant to take to the next slide. Not this one, the Varna Vyavastha, previous one. Okay, take to the previous one. Not even this one, okay. So we shall discuss the Varna Vyavastha. The word Varna has been derived from the word Vri, which means, from the Sanskrit word Vri, which means choice or to choose. So this is contrary to the assumption that Varna means color. Varna is not color. Normally we understand that Varna means color, but Varna is not color in our social sciences, in our sociology. So the word Varna has been derived from the word Vri, which means to choose or to choose. And it has come from a Sanskrit word. It has also other meanings like type, order, color, or class. These are also the different meanings of Varna. So in Rig Veda, it is mentioned that there are three classes of people in the society. The Brahma, who are the poet or the priest, the Kshatra, who are the warriors or the chief. The third division is a group of people comprising of the common people. It is believed that the four categories, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, these four categories have been originated respectively from the mouth, arm, thigh and feet of the creator. So this four, this Brahmin has been created from the mouth, these Kshatriyas have been created from the arms, and the Vaishyas has been created from the thighs, and the Shudras have been created from the feet. But there is nothing like higher or lower in Varna in Vedic period. The division of society into four Varna or order were based on the division of labor. At a later stage, the word Varna come to be used for the four social classes. That is Brahmins, who are the scholarly community, and their duty is to study and teach. The Kshatriyas, they are the warriors or the political community, their duty is to give order and protect. And the Vaishyas, they are the mercantile community, and they their duty is to raise livestock, cultivate and trade. And Shudra, the service providing community. So the Brahmins acted as priests, the Kshatriyas as rulers or fighters, the Vaishyas as traders, and the Shudras as in the service class. And each Varna worshipped different deities and followed different rituals, because each group had to achieve different object according to its occupational role. For example, the Brahmins worshipped Agni and recited the Gayatri Mantra. The Kshatriyas wanted physical strength, and they worshipped the Indra, the god Indra, and so on. Besides this, there was no restriction on the matrimonial alliances and even change of membership from one Varna to other. Among the four Varnas, a distinction appeared as Dyuja and Shudra. So who are Dyuja? Who are Shudra? The first three Varnas are called Dyujas. In other words, they are known as twice one. Dyuja means twice one, because they have to go through an initiation ceremony, which is symbolic of rebirth. After initiation ceremony, it is believed that rebirth takes place. And this privilege is denied to Shudras. So the Shudras do not go any kind of initiation ceremony, who are called Ekjati. Ekjati means once born. So here comes the word Jati. The word Jati is used sometimes as Varna, which is more often used to mean actually the numerous subdivisions of Varna. So it is Jati which is used as a vernacular term for caste also. However, there is a demarcation between the meaning of Varna and Jati and Jati and caste. Varna denotes four large classes, whereas Jati is the subdivision of Varna. And sometimes the term Jati is also indiscriminately used for Varna. Mahabharat declared there is only one Varna, that is Brahmin. In Santiprabha, the Rishi Vrigu mentioned that Brahmins became separated into different castes, different Varnas, in consequences of their works. The twice born men who were fond of sexual pleasure, prone to violence, fell into the condition of Kshatriyas. From these neglected, from those Kshatriyas, those who neglected the practice of their duties, they turned into Vaishyas. And from those who addicted to mischief and falsehood, they sank into the condition of Shudra. So this has been described by Rishi Vrigu in Santiprabha. And he told that there was only one Varna Brahmin, and gradually all these Varnas have been originated from Brahmin by neglecting their duties, because it is believed that one rebirths because of one's own action, one's deed, one's karma phala. So, but however, this is different from what Manu had said. According to Manusmriti, everyone is born Shudra. Action makes one Dyuja. Knowledge of Brahmin makes one Brahmin. So this has been told by Manu. However, both according to Manu and Vrigu, there is one common thing. The divisions into Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra are not according to birth or heredity, but according to one's own action, one's own deed, one's own karma phala, which is guided by inclinations, one's own inclinations. So now let us discuss what is the relevance of Varna Vyavastha. Why this Varna Vyavastha was there and what is the relevance of this Varna Vyavastha. The aim of fourfold Varna system in India was the division of labor. The theory of division of labor is one of the basis of one of the fundamental theories of social organization. It propounds orderly progress of work in society. That means the duties have been divided among the different people. So there is no chaosness, there is no disturbances. The duty of Brahmin was to see proper execution of works like study of knowledge and teaching and other religious activities. The defense and protection was left to the Kshatriyas. The Vaishyas carried out the agriculture, the dairy and the business. The Sudras served the other three Varnas. And the Varna system developed the social system. It is difficult to find a social system as systematic as found in Indian Varna system, because the objective of the Varna system was to maintain an organized and a balanced state of society. Another advantage of Varna system is that decentralization of power. What is decentralization of power? That is, if concentration of all power will be held in the hands of one class, they may lead to exploitation of other classes. So in Varna system, the power of knowledge, the power of army, the power of wealth, the power of labor were divided, distributed among different classes of people like the Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Sudras respectively. Thus, Varna system shows a fine synthesis of fundamental social organization, division of labor, and decentralization of powers. Now, let us come to the next basis of Hindu social system, that is Ashrama Vyavastha. The word Ashrama, next. Yes, this one. Ashrama Vyavastha. So the word ashrama originally derived from the Sanskrit word shrama, meaning to exert oneself. So ashrama is a place where exertions are performed, literally meaning ashrama is a resting place or halting place during one's journey of life for liberation or for moksha. So life is a journey. And the aim of life is moksha, liberation or salvation. And these ashrama vyavastha, these ashramas are different phases in our life. The objective of ashrama vyavastha was self-realization, happiness and spiritual liberation. According to ashrama vyavastha, the average life of man is counted as 100 years. The life of Hindu is divided into four stages, and each stays with 25 years. What are the four stages? The four stages are Brahmacharya Ashrama, that is the studenthood, Grahastha Ashrama, that is the householder, Vanaprastha Ashrama, that is the stage of detachment, and Sannyasa Ashrama, that is the stage of renunciation for salvation. So it is the dharma of each Hindu to pass through these stages of life. The first one is Brahmacharya. Now let us discuss what is Brahmacharya. The first ashrama is called Brahmacharya, the educational stage. It is the studenthood of one's life, from which the fourth varna, that is the Sudras and the women, were barred. That is, the Sudras and the women were not supposed to practice this ashrama or go through this Brahmacharya ashrama. This Brahmacharya ashrama ends at marriage, but till marriage, till this end of Brahmacharya, celibacy is prescribed. Brahmacharya literally means leading a life according to Brahma. This stage is marked by the initiation rites or Upanayana ceremony, which we called Vrata, Vrata Upanayana. So life of man becomes discipline only after he undergoes this initiation ceremony, which gives a spiritual birth or rebirth. Because of this, Upanayana, the Brahmins or the Kshatriyas and Sudras are called twice born caste. That is, once they are born physically and second time they are born spiritually. So this Upanayana or initiation ceremony is a spiritual kind of birth. So rebirth of a person takes place after Upanayana or initiation. There are particular age of initiation. A Brahmin is initiated at the age of 8. The initiation ceremony of Kshatriyas takes place at the age of 10. The initiation ceremony among the Vaishyas takes place at the age of 12. But there is exception. We can delay it. There is certain limits. That is, it can be postponed up to 12 years for the Brahmins, up to 14 years for the Kshatriyas, and up to 16 years for the students. So during this Brahmacharya Ashrama, a student stays at the Gurukul, which is the beginning of schooling in the Vedic text. A student not only studies, but also does various types of activities as assigned to him by the teacher, by the guru in the Gurukul. Dharma Shastras and Manusmita has described a number of rules and regulations concerning the student's daily activities, behavior, food habits, etc. during this Brahmacharya Ashrama. However, discipline is the most important aspect of this ashrama, which a student learns from the guru at the Gurukul. In this ashrama, an individual surrenders his life of sense, mind, and intellect. It was taught to restrain his senses and control his senses. The next ashrama is Grihastha Ashrama. This is the second stage of life, of human life. During this phase, a man marries, enters family life, earns living, and performs his daily personal and social duties. The major aim of Hindu marriage is dharma, which one practices in this Grihastha Ashrama. The married man performs five Mahayajnas in this ashrama. What are those five Mahayajnas? What are those Mahayajnas means? Five sacrifices. So what are those five sacrifices? Those five sacrifices are offered to the Brahmins, to the Pitrus, to the gods, to the Bhutas, and the man. Sacrifices to Brahmins were made by recitation of Vedas. Pitrus by Shraddha, by offering water and food. And gods by prayer. And Bhutas by body. And man by reception of guests. Entertainment or entering guests. Service to guests is a moral obligation and it is equated with God. So during this Grihastha Ashrama, a man is supposed to do these five sacrifices or these five activities. At this phase, he is expected to provide food to persons and animals, like gift to Brahmins and feast to students, medicine to sick and donation to poor. He is expected to feed the guests, the infants, the sick person, the pregnant women. That is, his duty is to service others, to fulfill others' needs, which others can't, but he can. And thereby earn dharma in his life. It is the phase for the attainment of three purusharthas at a time. Therefore, this Grihastha Ashrama is very, very important. In this phase only, man can achieve three purusharthas of life, that is dharma, artha, and kama. Therefore, Grihastha is given high place, high honor among all the four ashramas. Man is very responsible at this phase of life. All the three runas, the Devaruna, Pitruruna, Rushiruna, can be repaid only in this phase. Now let us come to the third phase, that is the Vanaprastha Ashram. After completion of the Grihastha Ashram, a man enters into the vanaprastha ashram. A man moves away from his duties from in the household. He devotes his time to religious practices. The man performs 5 yajnas in the forest. As regards to performance of duty, there is similarity between grahastha ashrama and vanaprastha ashrama. However, discipline is given more importance in this ashrama. There are restrictions regarding eating food. Eating meat is banned. There is restriction on pleasure and comfort. He must maintain celibacy and spend his time in studying the Veda and the Upanishads. During this vanaprastha ashrama, the presence of wife is permitted in the forest to facilitate the performance of several duties. Dharma and moksha are the main concern of life during vanaprastha ashrama. During grahastha ashrama, dharma, artha, kama, these 3 purusharthas are given importance. The three purusharthas are the aim of life. But in vanaprastha ashram, only dharma and moksha are the main concerns of life. Now let us discuss the last ashrama, that is the sannyasa ashrama. This is the final phase of ashrama vyavastha. Actually, a person is allowed to enter sannyasa ashrama either after vanaprastha or directly after grahastha ashram. So one can directly enter into sannyasa ashram after grahastha ashram, where a man is totally withdrawn oneself from the worldly affairs. He bids farewell to all the worldly desires, anxieties for family, for wealth, for the whole worldly pleasures. He should concern neither for living nor for death at this stage. And at this stage, a person recognizes the Supreme Soul by deep meditation. Through meditation, a man attains the ultimate end or goal of life, that is moksha or salvation. So this, in this sannyasa ashram, moksha is the only aim of life. But however, nowadays the Hindu way of life has changed, and neither the man are going through sannyasa ashram nor through vanaprastha ashram. Sannyasa ashram has almost become a dream nowadays. So these are the 4 phases of ashrama life, ashramas through which a man has to pass through his life. Now let us discuss, what is the relevance of ashrama vyavastha? The ashrama vyavastha is an integral approach to human life. Actually, it provides the basis for realization of all the purusharthas of life, that is dharma, artha, kama and moksha. It gives space, it gives opportunity for realization of the 4 purusharthas. It makes systematic division of all-round development of man's mental, moral, material, emotional and spiritual aspects of individual one after another. Man is able to discharge all his duties systematically and effectively. Ashrama system maintains a balance between the social life and the personal life, the social development and the personal development. But as I have already told, nowadays least importance is given to vanaprastha ashram and sannyasa ashram. Now let us come to the next unit. The next unit is purusartha and its relevance. So what is purusartha? The term purusartha signifies what is sought by man, what a man should do, what is the goal of man. It consists of 2 words, purusa meaning person and artha meaning aim or end. So purusartha is a psycho-moral basis of ashrama system. Purusartha means the aims or goals of life, and it has played a very vital role in the history of Indian social system. Then what are the 4 purusharthas which we already have discussed? The 4 purusharthas are dharma, artha, kama and moksha. What is dharma? Dharma means what is right, what is good. That is called dharma. In other words, the right activities are dharma. Dharma is a means to attain certain ends, and the ends are artha and kama. The last ends, the last goals are artha and kama. Dharma is the duty. It is the means to achieve moksha. We must observe, we must practice dharma to achieve moksha. In all stages of life, man professes the path of dharma, be it a student, be it householder, be it sannyasa. And the dharma in each stage of life is different. The dharma of a student is to gain knowledge, serve the guru. The dharma of a householder is to do service of others, to earn money, to artha and kama are the dharma of a householder. Likely, dharma regulates the artha and kama. If dharma is the common regulator of life, then moksha is the common aim of life. Dharma, dharma is a principle. It helps in maintaining social stability. The Veda are regarded as the principal sources of dharma. The Hindu dharma is also otherwise known as the Sanatan dharma. Dharma also leads to realization of Brahma. Dharma is considered as sacrifice, as yajna. It is getting of spiritual energy, practicing spiritual energy. It takes man from darkness to light, from falsehood to truth, and from death to immortality. So dharma occupies the higher position than artha and kama among all the purusharthas. So among all the purusharthas, there are four purusharthas: the dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Dharma occupies the higher position. Then now let us discuss artha. Artha meaning money, thing, or position. Artha also implies attainment of worldly prosperity, advantage, profit, wealth. So these are the meanings of artha. And it is a powerful org in human nature. Otilia says wealth, and wealth alone is important as much as charity, because realization of dharma is possible through artha. It has been told by Otilia, because artha helps in the attainment of kama and dharma. Now let us discuss what is kama. Ordinarily termed as pleasure. Kama is ordinarily termed as pleasure. It is enjoyment by five senses, by using the five senses. What are the five senses? Hearing, feeling, seeing, tasting, smelling. So we enjoy, we get pleasure through using these our five senses. The urge to enjoy pleasure and satisfy the desires is most powerful among man. Manu regarded kama as desire. It is the desire for pleasure. It can be sensuous pleasure. It can be mental pleasure. It can be sexual pleasure also. So everyone seeks pleasure or luxury in one's life. So artha is a means to attain kama, to get kama. The last purusartha is moksha. Moksha is to get rid or release. It is liberation. Moksha is regarded as the highest bliss in one's life. It is the last end in human life, and it is not that death which gives moksha. Moksha is an end in itself. If one dies, one does not get moksha, because he takes rebirth. One gets moksha at the end only. Beyond moksha, human has nothing to attain. So moksha is the realization or living the truth. We can call moksha as the sublime goal of human life. So these are the four purusharthas, the four goals of life. And now let us come to the next unit, The next unit is the assumption of the doctrine of karma. So, what is karma? So, what is karma? Karma means the work, what we do, the action. It has been derived from the root word, which means to make, to perform, to accomplish, or to prepare, to effect. So, the word karma means we can certainly understand action or performance, a duty, work, what we do. So, there are three essential features of the doctrine of karma. First one, it is an ethical or moral law. That is, good karma produce happiness and evil karma produce suffering. So, it is the first principle or first feature of the doctrine of karma. And second one is, it is the law of moral responsibility, in that the soul or atma of a person is responsible for bearing the consequences. That means if one does not do good works in his life or in her life, he rebirths. So who gets affected by karma? The soul is gets affected by karma. Then the third principle, the third essential feature is redistributive justice. That means rebirth of the soul or atma and rebirth in higher or lower forms of existence. If somebody has born human, but he has done a lot of negative works in his life, he has harmed the animals, he has done a lot of bad works, then maybe in the next rebirth, he may not be born as a human. He may be born as an animal. So this is redistributive justice. And if an animal has done better works in its life, then he may born as a human in his next life. So these are the three features of doctrines of karma. That means good karma produces good result, bad karma produces suffering, bad result, and the soul is affected by these karmas of human being. And third is redistributive justice. We take rebirth in the form, in a higher form or in a lower form, according to our karma. Now, let us discuss what are the assumptions of the doctrine of karma. That is, the doctrine of karma is based on the following assumptions. First one is definite result. Every individual has a definite result as per its physical, mental, and ethical activities. As I have already told, karma is not only physical activity, it is also goes beyond physical activities, it goes beyond our mentality. So every individual gets definite result as per his physical, mental, and ethical activity. The PPT is showing or it's not showing? PPT is not visible, na? PPT is not visible. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. I will check it.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Yes.
So, the second doctrine of karma is necessity of rebirth. That means there is, we believe, in the Hindu social system, there is the belief that the man takes birth again and again, depending on its karma. If it does all good work throughout his life, then one day the atma gets salvation, the moksha is attained by the human being. But till that period, one takes birth again and again. And the third is belief in the immortality of the self, that is, the soul is immortal. In the doctrine of karma, there is the belief that the soul is immortal. Only the body of the man, the body of the human being dies or perishes, but the soul is immortal. Then The next point is determination of general condition of life. That means our condition of life during our birth is decided by our karma. The doctrine of karma decides our papa punya, what we will get in our life, what will be our condition in our life when we take a rebirth. Then the karma is the supreme of all, because the theory of karma phala basically believes that every karma has its own results. So these are the few the doctrine of karma is based on the following assumptions. And now let us discuss what are the social consequences of the doctrine of karma. So the doctrine of karma has several social consequences in Indian society, and following are the consequences: karma and caste system. The first one is karma and caste system. The doctrine of karma has a profound impact on the caste system as practiced in India, because as we have already discussed that everyone is born Sudra. Manu has told everyone is born Sudra, but because of one's karma, one takes birth in the following life as Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Sudras. So if you do good work, maybe in the next when we'll born again, we will be born in a higher caste. So this doctrine of karma is attached to the caste system that is prevailing in our Hindu social organization. Then again, karma and non-violence. That means our activity, our karma is also related. What kind of activity we are doing? We are involved in ahimsa, we are practicing ahimsa or not. Then karma is the upholder of our social and economic status quo. That means if the doctrine of provides that the most rational explanation of inequalities in our life, our poverty, our happiness, our suffering of in our life, everything is depends on our past karma. So our status, social status, economic status, everything is dependent on our past karma. These are the product of each man's own karma in the previous birth. Then karma and social responsibility. This doctrine of karma has made us self-centered, not selfish. I mean to say self-centered. That means we always trying to do good karma, good action, and get moksha because of get liberation from this cycle of birth and death by doing good karma. Because every karma brings its results to us only, to that human being only. Then this is all about the doctrine of karma. So the doctrine of karma provides us opportunity and self effort that what we want to be in the next life, we want moksha or we want rebirth. Our rebirth, our moksha, everything depends on our karma or our activity. So these are the four bases of Hindu social organization. And in today's class, we covered the basis of Hindu social organization. We discussed some bases very shortly. And as per your syllabus, we discussed four bases of Hindu social organization in very detail. Those four bases are the Varna Vyavastha, the Ashrama Vyavastha, and the Purusharth, and the doctrine of karma. Over to Sangamitra Madam.
Thank you, Madam, for your wonderful presentation. Now I would like to request the learners, if they have any query or questions, they can ask directly or they can write in the chat box.
Yes, sure.
You can ask your questions here. If you have any query, you can ask. Okay, Madam, there is one question that what is about Jati? He is asking about Jati. पुरंदर बारिक इज आस्किंग अबाउट जाति.
Actually, there is a confusion between varna, jati, and caste. I would like to say that there is only four varnas: Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Sudra. But jati denotes the subdivisions within the varna. Sometimes this word jati has been used similar as varna, but those two words are not actually similar. Varna, there is only four varnas. That is full and final, but jati is the subdivision among the varnas. And sometimes we use the term jati with similar as caste, but that is also not correct. It is used for the term jati is used for varna, the term jati is used for caste, but these three terms are actually different. Varna is derived from the word vri, as I have told, that means through choice, it is not color. And jati is a term we indifferently use sometimes for varna, sometimes for caste, and we ourselves become confused, but it's not that. It is a subdivision within the varna. That is what I want to say. And there are numerous jatis and numerous, and within caste is also not same as of jati. There are numerous castes. Within caste there are sub castes, there are thousands of castes, there are thousands of sub castes, thousands of sub castes. For example, among the Brahmins there are, if we discuss about this western belt, there are Jhadwa Brahmin, there are Odia Brahmin, and among the Jhadwa Brahmin there are different sub castes. Among the Odias, there are different sub-castes. And if we go to the coastal belt also, we can see that your Sassini Brahmin, Panchadesiya Brahmin, and within Mishra Brahmin, Halua Brahmin. So there are different sub-castes, and there are different sub-castes also within the caste system.
Yes, one clarification, madam, as you would just like to ask the concept of purity and pollution, that if you can say on this topic a bit more.
Purity and pollution is one of the basis of Hindu social organization, and we can see purity and pollution in different aspects. For example, we can see the practice of and pollution is seen in different rite the passages of our life, during the death rituals, during the marriage rituals, during the birth rituals. For example, when a pregnant lady gives birth to a child, then the pregnant lady is considered as impure. The child, newborn child, is also considered as impure, and they are purified once after 7th day, after 12th day, and they are totally purified. And they become totally pure and sacred after 21 days. After 21 days, the women can do puja, she can do worship. And after 12 days only, the women can touch everybody. The child can also be touched by everybody. But the women cannot do worship. She cannot do cooking activities. She cannot enter to the kitchen. And before 12 days, if anybody touches the women and the child, then they become polluted. So this kind of concept of purity and pollution exists in our society. Then another kind of purity and pollution exists in the caste system. In the caste system, what happens? The upper castes, that is the Brahmin, Kshatriya, and Vaishya, they are considered as pures, and the untouchables, they are considered as impures. And if the untouchable caste touches the higher caste, the higher caste also becomes impure, and he has to purify himself by taking bath, by sprinkling of holy water, by changing clothes like that. And in South India, the concept of purity and pollution is so vividly present that in South India, even if the shadow of an untouchable person falls on a Brahmin person, then also it is considered that the Brahmin is becomes polluted by the shadow of an untouchable person. That is why in South India, in some places, the untouchable persons, they are not allowed to pass through the roads, in the common roads in the villages, the common roads where the higher caste people move during the daytime, the untouchables are not allowed to move during move in that roads during the daytime, because in the daytime their shadow will fall on the Brahmin people. So this kind of purity and pollution is also found in the caste system. Then also purity and pollution is found among the three gunas, as I told, that sattva, raja and tama. The sattva is considered as pure. It is considered as the Brahmins practice this. So this kind of concept of purity and pollution is found at different levels in our society.
Thank you, madam. Is there any question, any other questions you can ask? Yes, there is another question, ma'am. Madam, what is about Runo, ma'am? She wants to
that
know.
That is actually
again.
The Hindi term. Yes, that is actually the Hindi term. কোয়াজাই বাথরুম রুণ ওড়িয়ারে যেটাকে কোয়াজাই রুণ ইংলিশে ডেট দ্যাট ইন হিন্দি দ্যাট ইজ টার্ম ঋণ পিতৃ ঋণ দেব ঋণ ঋষি ঋণ দিজ আর দ্য ডিফারেন্ট ঋণস উইচ এ পর্সন হ্যাজ টু রিপে ডিউরিং ওয়ানস লাইফ টাইম পিতৃ ঋণ ইজ দ্য ঋণ থ্রু আওয়ার অ্যানসেস্টার্স থ্রু থ্রু বিকজ উই হ্যাভ বিন বর্ন ফ্রম দেম দে আর আওয়ার ডিসেন্ডেন্টস অ্যান্ড উই repay this rina by in different shraddhas. We offer food to our ancestors during their death anniversary. So that is how we repay the pitru runa. And rishi runa is the rina, the debt of the teachers that we also pay during our lifetime. Then deva runa, the rina or the debt from the god, because god has created us by offering prayer, by providing different kind of health, by serving others, we pay the deva runa. And also there is another runa in our Hindu society. We consider guests as all guests, consider also guests as gods. So in these three ways we pay the debt, the runa, because of whom we have come to this earth, because of whom we have attained our own position. There is also matru runa, that is the mother has given birth to us. Because of the mother, we could see the day of the light. So these are the different kinds of runas which we have to pay during our lifetime for the attainment of salvation and moksha. These are considered as a part of dharma in our life.
Thank you, madam. I hope there is no other question left. Dr. Jayashri, do you want to ask any question if you have any? Our learners are saying, madam, thank you. So if there are any other questions, then we can ask, else we can conclude.
Okay.
Another query I would like to ask, that this are the ashrama vyavastha, this stages of ashrama vyavastha, that is that are relevant in today's life or not? That just I want to ask, all these stages, this four stages, are these relevant in today's life? In if you could give any example or this thing.
Actually, in today's life, we are only practicing this Brahmacharya ashrama and the Grahastha ashrama. We are not, and to some extent, at home, people are to a very negligible extent, they are practicing Vanaprastha ashrama, but totally, we are not practicing the Sannyasa ashrama, because nowadays, the goal of our life has changed. earlier moksha or salvation was the ultimate goal of people. People were very religious and they were very spiritual minded, and moksha or attainment of salvation was the main of aim of their life. They were trying to get moksha, that we okay, next I will not burn as a human being. This life as human being is very sorrowful. Nobody was interested to burn again. So by doing as much as righteous things, by practicing dharma, by doing good work, by following the doctrine of karma, they were following a path of religious path and trying to get moksha. That was the ultimate aim of their life. But gradually the time has changed, the world has changed. Now we have become materialistic. We are giving importance to one purusartha. We are only giving importance to artha. Artha is one of the purusarthas, dharma, artha, kama, moksha. So nowadays we are giving utmost priority to artha and kama, worldly pleasures and economy, money. We are giving importance to those two arthas, and we are no more interested for, we don't believe in this rebirth, we don't believe in this karma phalas. Not all of us, but few, they do not believe in this karma phala, they do not believe in this rebirth, they do not believe in this presence of soul and life after birth and rebirth. Therefore they are not giving importance to neither dharma nor moksha. They are only in the, they are running behind this artha and kama. And for these two things, and for moksha, we need sannyasa ashrama. For moksha and dharma, the relevance of sannyasa ashrama and vanaprastha ashrama were for dharma and moksha, those two goals of life. But our goals of life has now changed. Our goals of life are artha and kama, money and worldly pleasures. And for worldly pleasure and money, we don't need to go to those two phases of life, those two ashramas. So now we are following only the first two ashramas. Brahmacharya has totally changed. The Brahmacharya ashram has totally changed. We are attaining education, a different form of education, up to 20, 25 years or 30 years. Then we are pursuing our grihastha ashrama till our death. And because of this, because our, the goals of our life have changed, the importance of the four purusarthas have changed. Therefore, these phases of life have also changed in the modern time.
Thank you for the discussion, madam. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. And also, you have covered all the four units, the Varna Vyavastha and its relevance, Ashrama Vyavastha and its relevance, Purusartha and its relationship with ashramas, and finally, the doctrine of karma. So, thank you very much. And now we would like to conclude the session here. Thank you.
Thank you, Sangamitra Madam. Thank you, Jayashri Madam.
Thank you, Nishant. I just forgot. So thank you, like Nishant, for this technical help twice. And I just forgot.
Yes.
Of course. Thank you for your help, Nishant, once again.
Thank you.
Thank you.